Our next segment was produced in partnership with the National Wildlife Federation. The Great Lakes are threatened by invasive carp, but the issue goes beyond our region. The National Wildlife Federation is exploring that in a full-length documentary film that you can connect to on our website. Here's a segment from that production.
This is Camden Bottoms Wildlife Management Area in Camden, Tennessee, iconic southern bass fishing waters. Bill Cooksey of the National Wildlife Federation has been fishing here for decades, but over the last few years, it's gotten a lot more dangerous.
I feel like I gotta arm myself for combat.
There you go, Butler. Look at that nasty thing.
He's laughing, but the impact of Asian carp on the angler or on the ecosystem is no joke. Asian carp are affecting our nation's waters, fisheries, and freshwater ecosystems, and the fishing, recreation, and tourism economies and lifestyles they support, from Kentucky Lake to the gates of the Great Lakes. Mike Butler is the CEO of the Tennessee Wildlife Federation, which has organized a broad coalition of stakeholders to fight the war on Asian carp in southern waters.
It's impacting recreation, recreational use, it's impacting lake home values, it's impacting all different types of things, including the health of the fishery. The simple thing that we've been focused on is building a coalition of about seven different states, including their U.S. Senate offices and their U.S. Congressman's offices, to focus with the federal agencies involved and all the state fisheries agencies involved to go find the resources financially, the money, to give our agencies who are tasked with managing the resource the ability to remove these fish and start to effectively lessen their numbers.
Commercial fishing has been used to remove Asian carp on the Illinois River, which is connected to Lake Michigan through the Chicago area waterway system, along with electric barriers. However, a silver carp was found on the wrong side of those barriers in 2017. It doesn't take many to establish a population. Robert Hirschfield is the water policy specialist for the Prairie Rivers Network, which advocates for solutions to clean up Illinois waters and prevent the transfer of invasive species.
They are harvesting them, they're pulling them out by the millions of pounds. That is fine to address carp where they are. That's an okay solution for that problem, but it's never going to solve the problem of preventing carp from moving into new territory, including the Great Lakes. If we want to stop carp from getting in the Great Lakes, we need serious barriers. Something like the Brandon Road Project, which is a suite of technologies that will be installed at the Brandon Road Lock and Dam in Joliet, Illinois.
The Brandon Road Project would replace the current lock and dam with an engineered channel fitted with smart technologies like an electric barrier, backed up with a water bubble fence, acoustic deterrents, and a flushing lock to stop Asian carp. Further east, Asian carp are impacting Indiana too, creating a mess of both the fisheries and the banks. Don Cranfill is with Wild Indiana Magazine and is an avid bass angler. He's joined by Dave Hosler, owner of Pilecast Fly Fishing, and the National Wildlife Federation's Drew YoungeDyke to see how they're affecting the fishing on the Tippecanoe and Wabash rivers.
This is typical to most rivers in Indiana right now. These things have devastated the rivers and creeks, and they've really affected the fishing. What scares me is that these things are gonna take over the rest of the reservoirs, and then we'll be, all of our recreational boating and fishing is gonna change forever.
The Eagle Marsh Berm in Fort Wayne, Indiana, completed in 2016, is all that separates these Asian carp from Lake Erie. Emily Wood is the executive director of the Indiana Wildlife Federation, which was instrumental in assembling the partners needed to make this project happen and stop Asian carp.
You know, when they started to do studies in the Great Lakes Mississippi River Interbasin Study, they discovered that this point here in Fort Wayne at Eagle Marsh was the point where it was the second most likely spot for Asian carp to make it up to the Great Lakes after the Chicago area waterway system. And so this is a huge infrastructure project.
Eagle Marsh connects to the St. Mary's River, which drains to Lake Erie, but under flood conditions, it also connects to the Wabash River, which is infested with Asian carp. So without the berm, a flood could put the carp from the Wabash into the Great Lakes watershed.
Not only is it a beautiful restoration, but it's actually serving a purpose of keeping the Wabash River, which is infested with Asian carp, from mixing with the waters of the St. Mary's River, which heads right up to Lake Erie.
As a scientist, charter captain, and tournament walleye angler, Ali Shakur has found in his research that if they're allowed to invade, Asian carp could survive and spread throughout the Great Lakes.
The rivers along the Great Lakes, there are several that have the correct parameters that allow spawning success. Some of the projects that I've worked on have shown that they could have negative impacts on food webs in places such as Lake Erie, Saginaw Bay, Green Bay, by out-competing some of the native planktivores, alewife, gizzard, shad, bloaters, for example, which would then have a cascading effect across multiple trophic levels of the food web.
Such an invasion of Lake Michigan would impact not just the big lakes, but also the inland lakes and rivers that help make up the Great Lakes' $7 billion fishery. And the damage would extend far beyond fishing. Michigan's $25 billion tourism industry, employing millions in restaurants, shops, and craft breweries and distilleries, and Michigan's $26.6 billion recreation industry, exemplified by small businesses like Sleeping Bear Surf and Kayak, owned by Ellis Scrocky's family, would also suffer.
We get an influx of tourists from out of state, as well as a strong community here in northern Michigan that comes up to enjoy the diverse ecosystem that we have in the Great Lakes region, and specifically here in the Sleeping Bear Dunes, which was the inspiration behind our shop. And if we had an influx of Asian carp, it would most definitely prohibit that influx of tourists and make it a bit unattractive for people to get in the water to paddle and surf and swim and enjoy the shark-free waters that we call home.
It's not just the economies that are at stake, though. Doug Craven is the Natural Resources Director for the Little Traverse Bay Band of Odawa Indians, which relies on the health of the waters for subsistence, commercial, and recreational fisheries, as well as a deep-rooted cultural connection to the water.
The health of the Great Lakes, the health of Lake Michigan, the health of the fishery are very important to the Little Traverse Bay Bands. So one of the big concerns that we have is invasive species and their impacts to the Great Lakes. So we're really concerned about the potential for Asian carp getting into the system and adding one more stressor to an already fragile environment.
Mark Smith is the Policy Director for the National Wildlife Federation's Great Lakes Regional Center and serves on the Great Lakes Commission.
So Asian carp are a national problem that requires a national solution. Our strategy of nationalizing this is working to remove them from existing waters in the south, but also trying to prevent them from getting into the Great Lakes. So we know that our efforts to keep carp out are paramount to keeping our quality of life and our economy here thriving, not only for us now, but for our future generations.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for our newsletter at greatlakesnow.org.